Welcome to you all. This is a wonderful gift we've just received. A Sorry. Well, can you hear me?
Yes.
Lovely. Thank you, Uncle Wayne, for this most wonderful gift. We've just received a picture of our journey here. So today, we were on now? Yes, okay. So today we're celebrating 50 years. Our journey, our dreams. Now I would like to start off with thanking all of you to come. Unfortunately, I thank Jamie Parker for our host, but Bon will say a few more words about his inability to come. So thank you to Uncle Wayne for the warm and generous welcome he's given us all to the land of Australia's First Nation. Thank you to our family, our friends, people who've come from a long, long way to be here. Each and every one here, in your own unique way, plays a role and have played a role in keeping us together and making today happen. So thank you. Also, a thank you to all the people, and I can't name them all, there are so many who've spent time organizing this. So thank you. Please feel our gratitude towards you. I also want to thank our own community elders, and there are quite a number of them here, who have shown great wisdom, tenacity, endurance, and friendship to get us to this stage and our community to where it is today. Finally, I'd like to pay my respects to our community's men who lived, whose lives were cut short due to AIDS during 1980s, 1990. And I compare the AIDS epidemic as being a war. A war usually means that you use lots of very bright young men, potential leaders for our community. However, our community did not suffer the complete demise. Instead, it showed its resilience and recreated itself into a blossoming, talented, vibrant community again. So thanks and appreciation goes to our current Liberation Warriors. You are quite a number of them here, so keep up the good work. Thank you.
Well, he goes on for so long, doesn't he? I'm going to be very short. What is the chance of saying?
Welcome
to everyone. It's just so beautiful to see you all here. Except there's somebody missing. Jamie Parker, who was the initial thinker for the idea of a party for us, said to us in Parliament House, when an elector turns 50, I send them a card. But this is bigger than that. So here we are, thanks to Jamie. And he writes, so, as you know, everything is in hand, and it should be a fantastic event. Unfortunately, I won't be able to attend as I have had to leave Sydney and will be out of Sydney until next weekend. So disappointing after all of the effort that has gone into the event that I won't get to see the fruits of our collective labour. I want you to enjoy the event and share your remarkable commitment with your friends and family. Please pass on my apologies that I'm unable to attend, but all my best wishes and love to both. Best wishes, Jamie Parker.
We'd like to share some special messages from friends and family who couldn't be here today. And we'd ask that you hold your applause to the end.
Firstly, from Nazazad, work colleague of Peter's at Bankstown. A relationship such as yours and the love you share, it's inspirational. Together you have created and lived an adventurous and pioneering life, one to be very proud of.
From Gerna Bonford, widow of the Reverend Ray Bonford, who appointed Bonsall to the job of St Clement's Mossman, from which he was sacked in 1972. I shall be drinking a toast or two on your day and pray for the continuing journey together and dreams that very often do come true.
From Martin Spencer Hogden, dear friend from Melbourne since 1962. As you well know, I have followed your lives, your fights and your achievements closely and with admiration over virtually all your time together. And I thank God for your determination and success in the face of contempt and, sadly, often vilification. I believe your efforts in the pursuit of love and justice have been heroic and huge benefit to oppressed and derided sections of the community. The end result is a better world than the one you burst upon.
From Clover Moore, Sydney's Lord Mayor. I write to congratulate you on your 50th anniversary. As original 78ers who marched in the first Sydney Gay Lesbian Mardi Gras, you played a significant role in establishing the strong and supportive GLBTIQ community we now celebrate in Sydney. I acknowledge your significant involvement in that community over many years. Your contribution as partners of more than 50 years is a powerful example of deep love and commitment, and shows what we can achieve when we work together.
From Alison Lesbina, cousin of Bonds, one could never have imagined 50 years ago that you could now so openly celebrate your lifelong relationship. You two have been at the forefront of these changes. You should be very proud. Your journey was no bed of roses, but your tireless work to get acceptance has and will make life so much easier for others.
From Rosa Barden, widow of Dennis, who was in theological college with Bond. I hope it's a memorable celebration of your good lives well lived, giving so much to various communities and important causes as you do. So what's your next challenge? Good luck to you both.
From Angela Johansson, Bond's cousin. Congratulations on your achievements and your inspirational journey. May you both continue to follow and achieve your dreams for many more years to come.
From David Connolly, through whom Peter and Bond met in 1966. As I've said on many occasions over the years, I carry a sense of great joy and pride that I was instrumental in introducing you to one another, not only because it was the start of such a long and lovely partnership, but because that partnership has borne such astonishing fruit for good in the wide community. You have each and both served for 50 years.
From the Right Reverend Kay Goldsworthy, Bishop of Gippsland, I hope and pray that your anniversary is a fitting occasion as you gather memories and make this one together.
From Mark Gillespie, a fellow 78er, my memories go back to the days of that Chequerboard program that meant a lot to me when I was an isolated young gay man living in the outback.
From David Hilliard and Ian Maidman in Adelaide, we will be thinking of you on the day with admiration and gratitude for all the good that you both have done.
From Robin Plaister, fellow foundation member of CAMP, the Coalition Against Moral Persecution. You two are an important link with my past, and I would have loved to have shared your celebration, but know that I will be thinking of you on the day, and I hope it goes off really well. I've really enjoyed all those years of politicking with you, and still remember with fondness those evenings spent at meetings fighting a good fight, both external and internal to CAMP. And also the lovely sandwiches that you supplied Mark and me at your home on Sunday nights as we all worked on into the evening.
From Ken Lovett, aged 94, and Manny DeSats, who turns 90 tomorrow, who are dear friends from Melbourne. We were there for your 40th, but your 50th is somewhat beyond us. So we send you 1,000 sparkling jewels of friendship beyond compare. May they continue to be enjoyed on your way to your next milestone.
From Gary James and Graham Carberry, long-time Melbourne-based gay activists and founders of the Australian Lesbian and Gay Archives. We appreciate the invitation and would like to make a donation in recognition of the many and varied contributions you've made to our lives, even at times when we didn't know you personally, such as the Chequerboard moment, and caring for people in unheralded ways. The documentation of Australian homosexual lives through the Gay and Lesbian Immigration Task Force history, political history, and unfit for publication strike us as monumental achievements to our community's history and sense of self. Thank you for all of that. With warm wishes for a very happy and memorable anniversary.
And our last message comes all the way from the UK. Jamie and Hazel Donnelly, two of Waal and Peter's honorary grandchildren, with appearances by their parents, Jane and Andy.
Let us remember for a few moments just what it was like 50 years ago when Bon and Peter fell in love. There was no gay community, just small social gatherings of camps, as they we referred to ourselves. A social club, the Follies, which is still going, a couple of bars, the Rex, the Quarter Deck, and venues which opened on weekends, such as Candy's Garden of Delights in Enmore, until Candy took over the Purple Onion at Kensington. Most socialising was done at home or on the beats. All very closeted, and for a very good reason. Society at large was hostile. Hostile to homosexuals. The general stereotype was of a high-pitched voice and interested queen, who it was thought, if it was thought at all, made up probably 0.05% of the population. Kinsey's 1948 report hadn't been widely read nor believed, though actually he came close to getting it correct. Now, while we all knew of rumoured hoofters and queens, usually in the entertainment industry, such as Robert Helpman and Frank Thring et al., there was no publicly self-identified homosexual man or lesbian woman, and for good reason. We were, in Gary Rutherspoon's words, naughty, sick, and sinful, though the reality was much more brutal. We could be incarcerated for long periods, subject to judicial torture with the assistance of the medical profession, and damned to hell for loving someone of the same gender. And in the past, men had been subject to judicial murder to be hanged for making love. Now, why has that been left out of Australian history? All that changed 46 years ago on the 10th of September, when John Weir was interviewed in The Australian with a photograph announcing the formation of the Campaign Against Moral Persecution, CAMP, Inc., a clever Australian acronym. John never wanted to use the American designation gay. 9 days later, there was a longer piece with another photograph of John, but now also with fellow co-founders Christopher Pohl and John's partner Michael Cass, whose back was turned to the camera because he was about to be interviewed for a job, in indication of the times. Crucially, this article included a contact postal address. John and Chris thought they were founding a small group of knowledgeable people who would counter the popular stereotypes about homosexuality, particularly in the media, and provide some support. Actually, they started a revolution. We can now talk of BC and AC, before camp and after camp. The founders were inundated with letters and quickly realised that a much larger society group was inevitable, and this was formally instituted in February 1971. Camp New South Wales, as it became known when other state branches formed, was something of an umbrella group, with various subgroups hanging off it, the social group, the legal groups, political, religious, the House Committee, etc. And these ebbed and flowed and changed over the years. The first club rooms were in Balmain, but later moved to 33A Lee Point Road, just around the corner and down the street, where they stayed until 1980. Now, let us not forget that becoming a member of camp, putting your head above the parapet, so to speak, required a great deal of courage, given the times. And among those foundation members were Peter Bonsall-Boone and Peter DeVoe. Each threw themselves into the life of this new organisation in different ways. Peter, an organisation, Bon heavily involved in Crossways, a religious group, as well as being secretary for a time. In those early days, the emphasis was not on equality as we know it today, but on liberation. Liberation of the self from the ingrained ideas and oppression, the ingrained homophobia that we were brought up with, and liberation of society at large from prejudice. To achieve this, emphasis was on coming out. Visibility was all important. So in 1972, when ABC TV's Chequerboard programme came calling, Chequerbon was the Australian story of the day. Bon and Peter, together with Sue Wills and Gabby Antolovich, and let's not forget actually that women have a part in this history. Too often, they're actually written out of this particular story of early gay movement and the lesbian movement in Australia. Bon and Peter, Sue and Gabby agreed to appear on the program as two couples. This was coming out with a vengeance. And many remember Bon and Peter and that first same-sex kiss. The first on Australian television, before Joe Hashem in number 96. But unlike that soap, this was for real. Well, I presume it was. It was a brave act, and it demonstrated their level of commitment to each other and to their relationship, now 6 years old. As we know, the proverbial hit the fan when Bon subsequently lost his job as church secretary at St. Clement's Mosman. It led to the third and largest homosexual demonstration so far seen, and a rare coming together of camp and the slightly more radical Sydney Gay Liberation that had split from camp earlier that year. This, of course, was small consolation for Bon, who was forced to seek other employment. What came next for Bon and Peter, however, was to prove of the utmost importance for the nascent gay community and for which they truly should be lauded, the founding of Phone a Friend. They installed phone lines in a spare room bedroom, and they began the first gay and lesbian counselling service in Australia. This was so crucial for the lives of closeted and isolated lesbians and gay men, especially in regional areas. We've heard already from one of the people who've written in. and for the first time, it provided non-judgmental advice on homosexuality, something that was not available at the time from the much lauded Lifeline, run by the Lesbian Mission, although Lifeline eventually did come on board. Phone a Friend was to become really the last subgroup of camp left standing, in a way, and this was acknowledged when in 1981 Camp New South Wales became the Gay and Lesbian Counselling Service, under the directorship of Terry Goulden, now incorporated in 2010. Before then, however, in 1976, there was the establishment of the Tribunal on Homosexual Discrimination, the organisation of which Peter was heavily involved with. Over a weekend, a panel, Dr. Jim Cairns, Bridget Gilling, Arthur Gitzel, or was it Barry? Arthur Gitzel, yes. Heard evidence of widespread discrimination against gays and lesbians. The subsequent report was a landmark document, and this and the... And this 6 years before homosexuality reported the New South Wales Anti-Discrimination Board. And also, there were seven subsequent reports on discrimination, position papers really, published by the Gay Task Force. Not enough was made, I think, of the findings of that tribunal, nor of the task force publications at the time, partly because of the intransigence of the Parliament and parliamentarians. But by late 1970s, Camp had moved more into the counselling organisation, was probably less seen as a law reform lobbying organisation, and that waited until 1980 with the establishment of Garrett's Lobby, an organisation which Camp fully supported. In 1978, of course, as we heard and we both know, both Peter and Bon were at the first Mardi Gras, and today are proud members of the 78ers. Others will talk about Peter's involvement in the importance of the Immigration Task Force and Bond's work in support of people living with HIV. I, however, would like to finish by jumping to the present and acknowledging their involvement in the Pride History Group, Sydney's Gay and Lesbian History Group, and in particular praise them for the publication of Unfit for Publication, the definitive listing of all cases of buggery in New South Wales. This is a massive undertaking by Peter, with Bond's assistance on digital input and as a researcher. And the result is monumental and definitive, as has been acknowledged by Dr. Graham Willett, probably the premier historian of the history of gay and lesbian activism in Australia. I think that, along with the establishment of Phone a Friend, will be the work for which Peter and Bond will be long remembered, lauded, and thanked by future historians. With Peter's dogged determination and Bond's gentle persuasion, this has been a formidable and loving partnership, a real achievement. It is a marriage, for better for worse, for richer for poorer, in sickness and in health. And long, long may it continue to blossom. My warmest congratulations to you both.
Next, we're going to hear about Peter's Tasmanian adventure from Ron and Jan Snashel, who have been together nearly as long as Bon and Peter.
Good afternoon. Earlier, Peter started talking and Bon said, I'm going to be much shorter. Well, I'm doing the same for Robert. Mine will be shorter than Robert. But thank you for that fantastic background. It was 1982, and I was the head of welfare studies at Hobart TAFE, as community service study was then called. I was sitting in my Hobart office when a bearded, energetic fellow knocked on the door and introduced himself as Peter de Waal. He was after some part-time work, and I was always looking for... Excuse me, guys, blood runs. Jane, can you come and duck over? Come. Where are you going?
Off you go.
Yeah. She's a nurse.
Oh, wow.
Okay,
let
me get up to it. Ron was always looking for people with talents that he clearly displayed, professional training, knowledge and experience of the Australian community, and personal skills and attributes based on a secular humanist perspective and on an ability to work with students, to encourage, develop and challenge them. I employed Peter on the spot, I think for 2 or 3 hour sessions per week. He started with a minimum of fuss, bureaucracy, another official bullshit, as we were able to do in those days. Peter justified all of my hopes and his promise, and the students loved his style. He was on sabbatical from Bonn. I didn't need to know why this man was here in Hobart, other than in broadest terms. Soon after, Bonn visited Hobart, and we met him at Peter's Tasman Street, North Hobart, somewhat exotic, rented cottage. Both of them visited our Lee Valley home for meals on a few occasions, and on one occasion, Bon famously fell asleep in the armchair. We were quietly pissed off to start off with, but later realised that not only was he weary from a round of festivities, but was comfortable enough with us to conk out. Since those days, we have visited them and stayed at Terry Street on our occasional Sydney trips. Our son Jamie, who met both Peter and Bon when he was a young man, also took advantage of their warm and open hospitality on several occasions as he grew older. We have supported their research into the historical impacts that attitudes towards gay men have had in a practical way, with verbal encouragement and by purchasing copies of the research and donating them to the University of Tasmania, to the library. We keep in touch with email and attended their 40th anniversary at the Balmain Rowing Club. What a fantastic spot for such a memorable day. And now, look at this place. Their 60th will have to be Parliament House in Canberra. Ron and I are thrilled to be here today and to wish our dear friends good health, many happy times in the future. Thank you.
Unfortunately, Tess had family issues to attend to today, so we will listen to a message that she has sent. I hope your afternoon is a total delight, full of love and laughter, as you both so richly deserve.
Thank you.
And now somebody who isn't on the programme, special speaker Adriana Atkins, who is of course Peter's dear sister.
I'm Peter's sister. When Peter left home, I was worried. because he was only 18 years old. But I was excited for him too. I came to Australia in 1960 and I was very happy to see him again. A few years later, I met Bonnie. For the first time, it was a pleasure to meet him. And soon found out what a kind, caring person he was. I'm proud to call him my brother. Although I have met over the 50 years many wonderful people, some of them are here. On this special day, to join in the celebration of Peter and Bones 50 years together, I would like to thank Jamie Parker, he's not here, but anyway, for organizing this special day for my brothers. Lots of love from Sis Adriana.
Thank you, Adriana. Bond's beautiful mother, Wynne.
As a 15-year-old, something like this seems impossible, and yet here I stand, acknowledging such a grand milestone in the life of Vaughn and Peter. I've known Vaughn and Peter for a very long time now, almost my whole life, and long enough to think of them as my grandfathers and for them to think of me as their honorary grandson. Isn't that something incredibly special? It all started with Vaughn and my father, Omar. Dad needed to learn English after coming to Australia for the first time, and who came to his aid? Peter Bonsall-Boone. Before anyone knew it, Bonn and his more than perfect partner Peter were part of our family. The older I got, the more I learned about them and the more I was inspired by them. It's not every day that a grandchild gets to go to symphonies such as the Sydney Symphony Orchestra, the Brandenburg and the Australian Chamber, to be introduced to the comedy of Dame Edna, and to march proudly with the 78ers of the Mardi Gras, all with their honorary grandfathers. I really can't emphasize the gratitude that I feel towards Bonn and Peter, who are more than honorary to me and always have been. You may ask what these two wonderful people have done to affect me in my life, even at an early age. Well, where to begin, really? I think Bonn, Peter, and I would all agree with Egypt. On my 6th birthday, Bonn and Peter gave me a book, Horrible Histories, Awesome Egyptians, a book title I remember still to this day. At the time, none of us had any idea what this would awaken in me. The book had all kinds of information on ancient Egypt that a 6-year-old like me just devoured and relished. For some reason, this book, out of all the books that I had read in my short lifetime, this book stuck with me. For years after that, Bon and Peter gave me all kinds of books and DVDs about ancient Egypt. I remember in year two, at the book character parade, where everyone dressed up as their favourite book character and brought along the character's respective book to showcase. You want to know who I dressed up as? King Tutankhamun, the joy bearer of ancient Egypt. You know what book I brought? My favourite book from Bon and Peter, The Tomb of Tutankhamun by Howard Carter, a big book consisting of 234 big pages. That's a lot for a six-year-old. Sorry. This phase that we now call the Egyptian obsession made me save, ever since that sixth birthday, every cent to go to Egypt. And in 2013, at the end of my primary school years, I did, in fact, go to Egypt and lived my dream. A dream that Bon and Peter nurtured and eventually caused to blossom. Now that I look back on that series of events, I really appreciate what Bon and Peter have given me. Before I finish up here, I just want to address how inspirational Bon and Peter are to me, and really to all of us. I mean, every now and then, I do what every grandson would do and help his grandfather up the Sydney Opera House steps when we go to a concert. But whenever I hold Bon's walking stick for him, I really do know that he and Peter are both carrying an infinitely larger and heavier accomplishments on their shoulders. Until I grew to know them, I could never imagine committing and fighting for something for such a long time with such dedication and determination the way Bon and Peter have, and that is such an inspiration to a young person in a world like this. It really is not only an inspiration, but a beacon of hope that in this world there are people like them who give so much to people and expect so little in return. Bon, Peter, on behalf of the two-year-old that you first met, all the way through to the young man standing in front of you today, thank you for being a part of my family, and congratulations for sticking together for 50 years. Keep on being an inspiration to each other and all those around you.
Championships in water and refusing requests to rename themselves the Darlinghurst Choir for fears the words gay and lesbian might offend sponsors of the competition and competing children's choirs. This year they celebrate their 25th anniversary. Please welcome the Sydney Gay and Lesbian Choir.
Sons and in law, give up the fight. We have only started. We have only started. We have only started. We shall not give up the fight. We have only started. We have only started. We have only started. Together in our future, in hand, holding hand.
Singing for a very long time. Senzanina from a South African song. You may have recognised it from the Power of One movie. And of course, We Shall Not Give Up the Fight, a bit about struggling, I think, in this time of a gay marriage controversy, whatever. It's an appropriate song there as well. I don't think we'll introduce this next song. I think you all know it if you'd like to sing along.
Ah, that girl. Watch that scene, dig the dancing queen. Ah, 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 ah. Friday night and the lights are low.
Looking out for a place to go.
Ah, where they play the right music. Getting in the swing, you run to look for a king. Ah,
coming this afternoon. I knew there must be one.
Thank you so much.
I had found a friend that night and suddenly felt safer and not alone.
Peter is very persuasive. He talked me into volunteering for the Glitter Committee, and subsequently I became its co-convener. I had never done anything like this before in my life and was feeling overwhelmed, but Peter said he had faith in me, and that was enough. He so inspired me into how to give back hope to the people in our community. So I continued coming in for the next 5 years. It was in those years I heard all the amazing work, early work, Peter and Bon had been involved with at camp, Bon's work at Community Support Network, fondly known as CSN. I left in 2001, just in time to see Peter receive Glitter's live membership on the 11th of July 2001, an honour he truly deserved, as he has been with Glitter then for about 12 to 13 years, including the time he dedicated to collecting Glitter history. He was a Glitter immigration advisor for about 8 to 9 years. During that period, he initiated and conducted the monthly information night for the new applicants. During that period, every Monday night, he advised individual couples about how to lodge their applications with the Immigration Department. During 1997 to 1998, he conducted a Glitter applicant survey, When Only the Best Will Do, a study of lesbian and gay immigration. And this was published in April 1998, and then Peter literally wrote the book on the Gay and Lesbian Immigration Task Force. History, a huge undertaking. The Glitter history was compiled and written between 2000 and 2002. The book, Lesbians and Gays Changed Australian Immigration, His Story and Her Story, and the two volumes, Lesbian and Gays Changed Australian Immigration, His Story and Her Story, all the documents are lodged and available at the New South Wales State Library, and all 25 archival boxes of the original documents were placed there in 2003. I still tell my clients about Glitter. I even suggest just 2 months ago to a client in search of hope to join Glitter, and that would be the best $100 they would spend. And when I joined, it was $25. That was nothing to what I gained from meeting Peter on that fateful night back in 1995. I was honoured to be asked to say something here today because when I had given this some deep thought, my voluntary work started with Glitter, and without doing voluntary work, I would never have worked at ACON as a volunteer at CSN and then employed by ACON permanently. Ironically, Glitter still holds its Monday meetings at ACON after all this time. You see, Peter, I possibly wouldn't have begun a career in community service if it hadn't been for you. I wouldn't have had the rich life and believe in this community if it wasn't for the inspiration and mentorship you so generously gave. I'm so grateful to you and love you and Bob for what you have achieved for our community. And the community is all the more richer for it. But more broadly, you model such a warm and beautiful relationship of 50 years together. Amazing. Congratulations to you both. Peter and Bon, I will always hold you both in my heart. Thank you. She's lived in Sydney for 16 years. Her friendship with Bonsall and Peter is around 10 years old, and she values it enormously. She's the manager of radio for the print handicap 2RPH, which is how she got to know our two anniversary rights. It's tricky to say. Could you please believe the people? I tend to extemporise, but I've been given a very short amount of time, so Bonsall did a wonderful interview for 2RBH on the occasion of its 30th birthday, remember, in April 2013. We got a group of foundation volunteers, which included Bonsall, together, and I talked to them about their memories of those early years. Do you remember that?
Yeah.
Liz Perry. By the way, it's still available on the 2RBH website under Archive, if anyone wants to have a listen. And it's wonderful. It was really wonderful to be able to share those recollections with you on. You'd think there would have been a whole stack of funny stories available, but there weren't really. It must have been a much more serious radio station than it is today. But maybe John Laws was watching from 2SM, because I know they had a studio above, didn't they? We do have hilarious things happening nowadays, like the time when a nameless volunteer, it's okay, he's not here today, came to see us, very distressed, exceptionally upset, complaining that the CD player in Studio One wasn't working, and complaining that the equipment never works at 2RBH, and it's a terrible thing. Anyway, Peter Worthington will remember this scenario. He went into Studio One to have a look and see what was wrong, and found, in fact, that this volunteer had put the CD in upside down. That's the kind of thing. Anyway, back to Bonsall. He's been with 2RBH since September 1983. The first broadcast was on April 18th, 1983, so he really can claim to be one of the foundation broadcasters. And here are some recollections. As a keen smoker, and we all know how keen a smoker Bonsall is, he fondly remembers the days when you could smoke in the studio preparation area. Hearing this actually made my toes curl. Imagine all the WHS issues we'd be dealing with if we were smoking in the studio. But most people were smokers in those days. We'd have absolute conniptions if that happened now. The station has always had money troubles, as do all small not-for-profits that rely on government funding. But once Bonsall tells the story, once back in those early days, the station was so close to being broke, it almost went off the air. But a wonderfully generous couple came to the rescue of the radio station, made a donation of $500, which wouldn't even pay the printing, monthly printing bill now, I can assure you. But it put us back on the air, thank goodness, for all those wonderful people who relied on the service then, and still do. Also, Bonsall told me the story of when the volunteers were asked to go through all the rubbish bins, the 2SM rubbish bins, to try and find old tapes that had been used by the 2SM people to be reused and recycled, we say, we should say, by 2RBH. Our volunteers don't have to do that anymore, luckily. More recently, Bonsall has been an extremely popular announcer, recording his programme Car Radio, and very innovative vintage car radio, which I believe Peter was instrumental in him to do. Car Wireless, sorry. And doing his two live shows, Features Forum and Parish Pump. His contribution has been as extraordinary as his popularity amongst our listeners. When I was a baby manager, I remember one day being so deeply impressed on opening the mail, when I found a fan letter. I'm not kidding, it was a fan letter. Not for me, not for anyone, but for Bonsall, and this person asked for an autograph, photograph, do you remember that? Nobody else has ever had a fan letter. So, staff, volunteers and listeners have sorely missed Bonsall since he's had to scale back his volunteering, but especially me. I used to look forward to his Friday lunchtime visits, even when he would bring with him the possibly not too sweet-smelling fish dishes he liked. He still does like, don't you? Still don't like eating them. And he would come in and share lunch with me in my office. It was lovely. And I was able to experience him long after he'd left the office, because he was a runner. But most of all, I miss his gorgeous, lovely, silly, smiley, giggly, naughty, and much adored face. In conclusion, and on a personal note, I've been privileged to become part of the Chequerboard family in recent years, and I wanted to say how honoured I am and how lucky I feel to be part of that family. And I wanted to also to echo one of the messages that came in the apologies earlier this morning and say that I wish our two lovely humans many, many thousands of sparkling jewels of friendship and love for my husband, who can't be here today, sadly. A happy anniversary, I love you both.
I have a history of if it has wheels, Bonsall-Boone. And these are my first wheels. That beautiful wickerwork crab here, I was given a job. We went shopping up to Glebe Town Hall, Mum and I, go to the grocer, to the greengrocer, and then we finished up at Gay's Butcher. There was Fred Gay and John Gay, and there was another Gay there too. I was never sure why Mother parked my pram outside. Maybe she didn't want the Gay bit to catch. And maybe she didn't want me to see all these poor butchers in those days with 3, 4, 5 fingers all missing as they chopped up their wares. So I was always parked outside Gay's Butchery, and my job then was to throw out of my pram all the groceries and green groceries that had just been put in it. The second little vehicle is, the second little vehicle was my second one that was converted by my papa into a shopping trolley in later years, and then my first car with the lovely bogey lying against my front. Right. I don't know where those beautiful curls are gone. They're certainly gone. After my mother died, I searched the house for a blonde curly wig, but apparently it was real. This time, of course, my father was just about to go overseas in the Queen Mary to Palestine. There he is, a lance corporal with little me at in Mapunga Street, Concord. We had a weekend at Kirkhill. My godfather, who's there, was a great sandcastle builder, as you can see. The swimming costume, of course, it was the middle of wartime. You didn't just go to David Jones and buy a swimming costume. Your mother knitted it. And each year, she knitted a bit more on the front bit and a little bit more on the ribbons so that it would last for another year as you grew out of it. And it was my godfather, really, whom I had to thank for my name. He was baptized John Smith. He was an artist, and on one occasion he had a large canvas under his arm and managed at White Bay to knock the conductor off the tram with the canvas. Of course, what's your name? John Smith. Oh, yes. So John Smith became Sydney, where he lived, Woodward, his mother's maiden name, Smith. That's why I'm Bonsall-Boone. Maiden names included in all this. School days. First day at school is on the left, and that other one isn't my last day at school. It's my first long trousers. Those hats wore out at the front every year. I had to have a new hat. All the Sydney High Boys did. We were required to raise our hats to any ladies we saw. So of course the front wore out in no time. For those of you who haven't seen my socks, they've got treble clefs and music on them. Simply because when I came home from school on the first day, I went to the piano and, to my mother's horror, played God Save the King on the piano. I was whipped up to the local convent to have music lessons within about 2 minutes, I think it was. And of course I've been playing the organ for many, many years, but I started with the piano and violin. One of the important times of were the holidays that we spent at Barnbar with my Auntie Ella and Uncle Ivan. That's their house there. And the one with the lambs, although it was on the Liverpool Plains, the land was not quite good enough for sheep ewes to be able to bring up more than one lamb. So twin lambs were brought to the house and fed with a bottle of milk. The one in my arms is little, and my aunt was able to go to the paddock 8 years, 9 years later, shout, "Little Myrtle!" And this ewe would separate itself from the rest of the flock, and rush over to see us. Oh, more wheels, good heavens. Real motor car number one, Morris, 1936. Number two, I think probably my favourite, that Renault 750. I've just got my licence here. That was our family car. And, of course, the pinnacle of my car ownership was this Jaguar. Bloody cows for miles, mate. There wasn't a single animal anywhere between Hay and Littleton that day. Just a warning sign. St John's College, Morpeth. Our dreams. My major dream as a teenager was to become a priest and to work with the Anglican Church, but things were rather different then, and somebody happened to tell the bishop that I was there for that I was a convicted criminal. And so the bishop came up to the college, gave me a week in retreat. Jesus and I got on beautifully. And Jesus said, "Go ahead, Bonsall, you're the one in the right." So the bishop came back the next week and he said, "What did you want to do for the rest of your life?" I said, "I want to live with the man I love." There you are. It works. I'm the third from the right in the back row with the halo slipped off. And for the part of the college where I lived is at that Bergman house there. Another very important person in our lives has been Sister Constance Agnes, who will shortly appear. Oh, there she is, yeah. Sister Constance Agnes, in the days when she was an Anglican nun, in the days when they wore all their habit and stuff, and in the days when she was getting... She did die at the age of 88 in normal clothes. Well, she didn't actually. She died in the bath, so I don't suppose she did. She was to come for a holiday with my mother, and for some reason mother had to go away. And I said, "Oh, Sister Thompson, come stay with us." And she said, "No, not much," and then I didn't hear from her. So I rang her back, she was in Melbourne, and she said, "I don't think I should come to stay in a bachelor flat." I said, "Sister, this is a gentleman's residence. Put Reverend Mother on. Reverend Mother came on and said, "Oh, can't Sister Constance be a nuisance? Of course she can go up and visit you." The curtains in our dining room were lovingly sewn by hand by Sister Constance Agnes, whenever that was, 72 or something probably. Guess who this is? You don't blame him for loving that face, do you? Just how he looked when we first met. Another busy time I've had is in Glebe organs. This is the choir of St Paul's, Malvern and Caulfield. See how much in love we were. Just up there, there's Peter. To get him into a church choir requires a lot of love. just at the console, we're still organising. St James is the parish church of Ponsall village in Derbyshire. It has a magnificent organ. Like much of the Church of England, of course, numbers are going down and down and down. St John's, whose list of rectors starts in 1125, was of course a parish for many hundreds of years, but it's now one of six local parishes all gathered together into one. How on earth they afford to maintain this magnificent organ, I don't know. Somebody must have left a hell of a lot of money years and years ago for the maintenance. Being a long-time fingerer, I thought, if I press this harder, it'll come louder. So I pressed it harder, and it started to slide across the table. I had to call Nandine to come out of the audience and hang on to this wretched keyboard for me, so I didn't push it off onto the floor. This happy picture was St. Clement's Mosman, of course. I was there from 68 till 72 when they asked me to resign, and I said I had nothing to resign about, and so I made sure that they what did they do? Dismissed me. Next, yes. this was the cause of the problem, of course. This chap just happens to be part of me. And we can still do this. Yes. The following is, as we've been told today, the third and biggest day demonstration was outside St Clement's Church on the following Sunday. We invited this man to be here today, but unable, unfortunately, he wasn't able to be with us. Homosexual people are. People do. That's Dorothy Simons wearing her going to church dress. Dorothy never went to church. But she did have a hat with a nice veil, and she did go to church at St. Clement's on that occasion. CSN days. There I am, the suit tailor again, blue one this time. But this was a trust thing, exercise. That poor person in the black had to trust us not to drop her. Thank you. Oh. That's a little thing that I do at the moment. Wrap with love. You do 25 centimetre squares of knitting. They're all joined together and they're given to people in Australia or overseas, anyone who would be cold without them. In 1966, there was no such thing as a rainbow family. Well, there undoubtedly was, but no doubt they were not acknowledged in the community. Here today we have a wonderful collection of grandchildren. Coral, driving the car. Jamil, from whom you've heard. Jamie and Hazel, the ones in England. And Pippi, there at the end. I did recognise you eventually, though. So, we weren't able to have children. I would have liked to have had children, but it really wasn't on then. How lucky that our dream has been fulfilled and we have these beautiful grandchildren. Thank you. Accommodate gay people within the post office happened on the 26th of February this year, and we were photographed with the thing there and then with hats on there. And we couldn't even hear them, don't we? Yes. Thank you very much. We go on to the future and we hope that the millions and billions of gay and lesbian people in countries where they can be imprisoned and even killed will have a better future than that. A better future, a future as good as our past has been.
Mum, a terrific housewife, as they used to be called,
and an extraordinary nurture. Here I'm about 1 year old. And my dear sister Adriana, I think she's about 5 years. And like always, she's been with me and with us ever since I was a child. Now here she might be wondering, what's he going to do next? As you can see, I'm held back by the playpen because I'm ready to do my life journey. A big moment in 1946 when my older sister got married. I was 8 years old, so just a year after the war. And we were all 4 years apart, so she was about 12 years older than I am. The war had just finished. I don't know how they managed to have a wedding then, but we did. Obviously, their wedding was much, much smaller than our wonderful occasion today. I think there might have been 20 people, if that. During the war, our family was moved around by the German occupiers quite a number of times. This being our third abode during the time, in the 5 year period. And my sister's wedding took place in the front room of the house, which is, you can see, circled with the yellow, I think it's yellow. Fond memories of 1949, my school photo. They weren't all in the same class, but they were all at the same school. And I've not often stated that, but this school was for slow learners, which I was at the time. I didn't learn to read until I was about 10. It was at the school, at this school, that I realized that I was different. But I had no idea what to call it. I just felt different to all the other boys. And of course, there are some boys there who had a big crush on me. My school was very keen to put on plays, school plays, and they usually happen towards the end of the year. And I've been in two of those. This is only the second occasion you will see me in drag. And it's at that moment when I'm telling my husband about the Immaculate Conception. How erotic that could be. During 1952, we regularly visited the swimming pool, the 1952 one you can see on the slide. It is here where I first experienced sex with other fellow students. You can see it's still a similar building right now because I saw it last year, but it's now called a fitness center. I wonder if it's the things are still happening that I experienced. The 5th of May 1957 was, 5th of May 1957, and that is on the Dutch National Liberation Day. I think I started a journey of my own liberation to some extent. So I was nearly 19 years old here and out on an adventure and journey to a strange and foreign land, very, very far away. My trip took 72 hours, and I don't know how many stops we had in the super constellation, but many. I was like a 10-pound pom, except without the whingy. I spoke very little English and I was unskilled. Next year it will be 60 years on the 9th of May, and the dear friend Bill Scott, who is here today, we travelled on the same plane that time. I think, Bill, we should look at perhaps holding a party or something together. Good. Now, times have not always been so happy. So in late 1960, when I was already in Australia living at St Kilda, there were some dark times, full of doubt about my sexuality, shame, because I didn't feel normal. I was lonely, isolated. At that stage, I felt that there were only two options. One was to accept for who I am, or to commit suicide. Now, It's 1966, Melbourne Cup Eve. I was living in Melbourne at the time, and there was a fancy dress party. And my idol at the time was Melanie Dietrich. I think European gays, you know, really admired her. And also, I tried to say a few words. It's been from the coffee's voice. Of Liebe Eichenstein. Wonderful song. I mean, I think the English version is Falling in Love Again, but the words in German are much better than that. So, this is the second occasion you will see me in drag. I'm on the right on the slide. And I might add that I actually made that dress myself. I hired the wig, of course, that wasn't real. Sorry, I'm a bit. I didn't believe that long-term relations were possible when I was, you know, in my early 20s. And look at us now. So on the 31st of October, 66, we had our first outing as a gay couple. We did meet somewhat earlier, but it's really hard to determine exactly when. So this is the day we thought we should celebrate. Now, Bob was very keen right from day one, I think, to move in together, and to me, being Dutch and being a bit, I don't know, conservative maybe in that respect, I thought we need to wait. So I got him to wait for about 6 months. And then I couldn't wait any longer. Early in our relationship, my dream was to have a house of our own. I wonder if it might have had to do with being working class, being an immigrant. And somehow, in the back of my mind, someone told me at some stage, if you grow old in Australia, if you have your own house, you'll survive. And I think that's very true. Anyway, there you see the before and after. So 1970, it was all bright with Mediterranean blue. Green now, in many ways. Now, for some years prior to camp coming into existence, Bob and I had been saying to each other, this is for about, you know, 5 years or so, 6 years, I wish there was an organization or something we could join, because we both had this amazing belief that if people got together, we could change things. And we did, of course, as you can see. So camping was the journal of campaign against moral persecution, and about December 1971, we came out for Christmas for other people. Here you've got the other version, you don't get the kiss in mine. He took the kiss. So this is our coming out at a much grander scale on national television in 1972. And of course, it needs to be remembered that in 1972, we still had on the psychiatry book, I don't know what that is called exactly, that homosexuality was a mental illness. So we were basically mad, or we could be declared mad in 1972. Also, for expressing our love, we were potential criminals in 1972. Just to add a little bit, it's all right, coming out was, and I think still is, a very important thing to do for gay and lesbian people. It is something we often have to do again and again and again, just to show our identity. Here I am, one of the dreams I had in my life. Remember, I said I started in a slow learning school. I couldn't read until I was about 10. Here I am graduating at Macquarie University in 1980 with a double major and a diploma of education. What an amazing achievement of a dream that was for me. It was made possible, we were in a three-person relationship at the time. Michael Clossy, whose lovely sister and niece are here today, encouraged me, and he was my mentor to make it happen. Bon as well supported me financially, so I could do this. Now, while I was involved in camp, many years ago, I was very fortunate to have lots of women who were part of camp. And they taught me a lot about sexism, feminism. It was just an amazing thing to have those women involved in my life. Now, out of that grew, although it was a few years later, in 1985, I wanted to learn to trust other men with my feelings and my emotions. In order to do so, I joined a men's group at George Street. And Peter, who was part of the six men who met every week for a whole year, Peter is here today, so nice you're still a friend, thank you. So we did learn to trust each other and be emotional with each other, which is difficult for a lot of men. Wow, what an amazing time at Glitter, the Gay Lesbian Immigration Task Force, as Debbie has already described to some extent, to help to go through the applications of couples who are lodging an application. And what a wonderful satisfaction it was when they came back, probably after a year or so, because the process was very slow, very long, for the couple to come back and say, yes, he can stay, or she can stay, wonderful. The other thing with Glitter, which I think is probably worth noting, we used to get some feedback sometimes from the immigration department, from some of the workers who worked at the department. And they told us how delighted they were with Glitter's applications because they were so well put together. So, wonderful time. And as you can see, I was awarded the life membership in 2001. Another milestone was after I'd written the Glitter history, to have the book launched at Parliament House by Bob Devers, who was then the New South Wales Attorney General. What an extraordinary occasion that was, and we had the wonderful gay, lesbian choirs came and sang in the Jubilee Room as part of the celebration. Because of writing the Gay, Lesbian, Immigration Task Force's history, I was awarded the inaugural George Duncan Memorial Award. I must admit, I shared it with somebody else, but I'm very happy about having to share it. This was presented by what's now the South Australian Premier, and unfortunately, on the day I was to be awarded this award, I was having a big operation in Prince of Wales Hospital, and dear Josine Gillis, she stood in for me and read my speech on that day. So, thank you, Joe. The next dream, I suppose, is to have put together a publication called Unfit for Publication. It documents the New South Wales male-to-male sex offences, starting from white settlement to 1930. And on the occasion which is portrayed here, Michael Kirby launched the online version of it. So now, the last slide is that our journey, our dreams, they do continue. Obviously, we still have dreams. And I will just go through just a few of them. We hope and dream that our community remains vigilant, strong, committed, and idealistic to safeguard and make further progress to what has been achieved. And Bon mentioned it to some extent, Bon and I, we often think and dream about and talk about our dear sisters and brothers who live in countries, for example, the Middle East, in Africa, Eastern Europe, and there are other places as well, but this is just an example, where their lives are oppressive, to say the least. They, in fact, are living now under conditions which are much worse than ours ever were 40, 50 years ago. And is it too idealistic to dream about having one day soon an Australian foreign minister who does speak up or lodges a diplomatic protest every time atrocities are committed against our community overseas? Finally, Bon and I had a dream for quite some time to get married. To me, that is. It's taken me some time for that dream to become mine as well. So we would like to have been married today. But as you all know, that isn't possible yet. Our marriage, if we had it today, Our marriage would have been an expression of our love for each other and commitment, but also would have been an expression of and wiping away the second class citizen label we currently carry. So believing in becoming equal one day, we will start wearing the generally accepted symbol, the wedding rings. So Jamil our honorary grandson, could you please do us the honor of placing the rings on our fingers? So here we are, we're nearly there.